right, everybody's just at the pool of Bethesda waiting for the moving of the water, I guess. All right, just thank God for all of you this morning. I really appreciate the Spirit of the Lord, and I really am just excited about our praise team. Too bad Sister Brianna is leaving next week for a month or so, a couple of months, I guess. But she will be returning, and she's become a very powerful force with the praise team, and we really appreciate our regulars, Sister Dorothy, Sister Denise, and Sister Sharon, and Sister Hurd, yes, Sister Hurd, that's Sister Sharon. All right, so I just really enjoyed that this morning. I said I could listen to that a long time. And they could sing all these songs, and I think that we're at a point where we can do it ourselves. We don't have to go out and get somebody to come in and sing to us. I think that we are at the point that we can be self-sustaining, self-sufficient. And I like that last song, My Hope Is Built. Amen. I just could have parked there. I just could have parked. Amen. Joseph, you can sing too, right? All right. So we might have to get you to join us. He can do it. He can do it. Talented brother. But we do look forward for God doing great things. And I'm asking Sister Denise to do the same things Sister Dorothy did this morning. They can do it. They can do it. Denise can sing song after song and have everybody on the floor. And Sister Tia, and I believe we got everything we need in the house. I don't know about y'all. Of course, Brother Josh is, he's very stable. He's been with us now for about, how long? 3 years? Amen. So we really appreciate it. Appreciate Brother Derek. Amen. Push on the shelf, he can sing and play and do all the other technical stuff. So we just really appreciate all of these blessed and anointed people of God. Amen. All right, I don't think we have to long for any lack of anointing. As well, amen. Because I think that we have the anointing. We have the anointing in this place. Amen. So we just want to, let's just encourage our seniors. Amen. Take them out every once in a while. Encourage them. Lift them up. Because they're doing a good job. Let's say praise the Lord for them. Amen. All right. I'm so happy for Sister Sandra's with us today. She said we can only see it more. We're going to hold her to that. She said we're going to be seeing more of her. She was formerly down in Texas working for several months, but she's back closer now. So we're going to be looking for her. You know, I don't know whether I dreamed this or not. This morning before day, the Spirit of the Lord just said, call Sister Sandra, make sure she's there today. I don't know. I don't know what that was, but I had planned to do it this morning, but it slipped my mind. But that Spirit, I guess 3 or 4 o'clock, just said, call her, see if she's in town. And just tell her and make sure she's there today. Amen. Really? Okay. Well, I'm still with the Spirit of the Lord. I've been confessing all through the week. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And he has anointed me. Amen. Anointed me to see things and say stuff. And amen. Confess the word. He has anointed me. So I just thank God for the anointing. All right, Sister Brianna, you about to get used to us now? We're going to fix another dinner, hopefully. Y'all need to, amen, take note, amen. But the more love you show, amen, the more people will be attracted to what you're doing. Let's say praise the Lord. All right, I just want to share this morning. I'm talking about holiness, and I don't know whether that's taken that well with everybody, but the reason why I'm doing that is because we're living and we're experiencing more worldly control in politics and our environment and government and every aspect of our life, all the institutions, everything is pointed and is pointing toward the world's domination. Amen. So so somebody needs to talk about love not the world. How many can say amen? You know, if I had to preach this all over again, this message on love not the world, I would preach it this way. I said, don't pitch your tent towards Sodom. Don't pitch your tent towards Sodom. If you really understood Lot's story, you would understand the dangers that the world can present to the people of God. The dangers. So the scripture says, come out from among them and be ye what? Separate. Amen. Your life should be a life unspotted from the world. And those are scriptures that I feel that we need to hear. What we are saying is that we are not to build intimate relationships with people that are not saved, that's not of our faith and persuasions, that have the same values. We are not to develop strong ties to those people, because rather than changing you, sometimes people say, I'm strong enough, I can take it, I can go to the club, I can go anywhere, I can go to the strip club, I can take any of it, I'm strong. Amen. But that is not what the Bible tells us to do. The Bible didn't tell us to run to the world. It tells us what? Flee. Abstain. What? Run away. Have nothing to do with the unfruitful works of darkness. But what? Admonish them to turn to God. Amen. That's the thing that we need to do. Amen. I just want to, if y'all don't mind, I'd like to read some of those scriptures that I've been talking about for the last several Sundays. Because many times the saints, everybody said the saints, sometimes they're a little slow. The Bible says, be swift to what? Hear and slow to what? Speak. Sometimes we have to hear things 50 times. Amen. Sometimes we have to hear it over and over and over before it really what? Sticks. Amen. But the word is designed and calculated to stick. Amen. To the end of the journey. That's the power and the ability of a postage stamp. How many know the power of a postage stamp is in this ability to stick to the end of the journey? Amen. That's the reason why you got that. It's sticky on one side, right? It's sticky. It has the power to stick to the end of the journey. How many want to stick? All right. If you want to stick, you can't pitch your tent toward Sodom. I'll tell you what that means after. All right. Let me give you some of the scriptures that have really impacted me. I would admonish you to try to meditate these scriptures, because the only way that we can become doers of the word of God is that we have to meditate. Everybody just say meditate. They may tell somebody, say, do you know what meditate means? Okay. Well, meditate doesn't simply mean just what? Just reflect on the Bible, just read it up. Just casually, amen, to read scriptures. Meditate means that you have to what? You have to get involved in what? Verbalizing. Things don't become a part of you until you begin to what? Say them. Tell somebody, say, did you hear, Pastor? You got to say them. You got to say them. And some of y'all perhaps don't even know your timetables now, because you never said them. Repeat it. Some of y'all forgot them, and amen, never have learned them. That's just what's 12 times 9. I got you now, 12 times 9. What is that? All right, I heard one person that knew it. 108. So y'all didn't say them enough. when y'all were in what? Grade school. You have to say these things repeatedly in order for them to become a part of you. Now, after you begin to get old, like me and some of the others in here, Brother Wendell, I'll let you slide this thing. But when I look up a telephone number in the phone book, sometimes I forget the number before I even dial it. That's really getting what? All right, so I'm not going to give nobody a piece of my mind. I ain't got enough, amen, quite myself yet, but I'm claiming, let this mind be in me. I have a mind of Christ. I'm claiming that. That's amen. But I have found a good way, Sister Shirley, to make it stick when I look it up. A good way to make it stick, I just say it out loud. 584. Say it loud. And when I get ready to dial, that whatever I have already verbalized, it jumps out, and I'm able to retrieve that information. And I remember years ago when Sister Hill was acting, and that's how I really got really interested in her. Amen. When she was an actor in college, and I like her dress and how. Amen. Somebody said I like your walk, talk, and structure. That's what the boy used to say. All right, I ain't been saved all my life. I remember a few things of the world, but Bible said, "Love not the world." All right, and that's where I got really interested. Amen. When she was acting. Amen. And but I remember that she used to spend long hours. Sometimes I wanted to see it and I couldn't because she was going over her lines, pages after pages after pages. I wonder how in the world she learned all of that. And then she could get up and act it out. I mean, it seemed like she was the real character that she was trying to what? Portray, yeah. And she said that thing so much. I mean, she said it so many times, over and over and over and over and over to herself, saying it out loud. Until when she got up to act, she felt like she was actually the character that she was trying to portray. And that was the secret of her, amen, being able to learn all of these things, because she heard herself. She heard herself say these things. And so a part of meditation is you got to say things out loud. Amen. That's the reason why I would never say I can't live free from sin. I would say this: sin shall not have dominion over me. That's better. Sin shall not have what? Dominion over me. And if you say that enough, although you might be what? Hidden and missing in your walk with the Lord. Amen. Things will begin to firm up after a while. Because the Lord said, I create the fruit of your lips. That's how you frame your word, your world, and your life. You frame it with the words that you speak. How many believe that? Amen. Amen. One, Sister Banks. Oh, I appreciate you, Sister Banks. Oh, I appreciate you. All right. She knows what I'm talking about. All right. And the Bible says that the mouth of the upright shall deliver them. I want you to turn around and repeat that. Quote. Have you forgotten it already? I heard somebody that said one thing. The mouth of the upright shall what? Deliver them. Amen. How many want to be delivered? You overcome by the what? Blood. That means what Jesus has already made or done, made available and accessible. That's the works of redemption that have already been finished. Amen. So you were saved, you were delivered, you were blessed 2,000 years ago. That's the legal aspect of your what? Redemption. But it won't become real to you until you what? Confess it with your mouth. That's the reason why the Bible says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth, the Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. But with the heart. Everybody just say with the heart. Man believeth. Oh, I love it. Man what? Believeth unto righteousness. With the heart, man believes. So belief comes as you begin to hear the word. Faith comes by what? Hearing. And hearing by what? The word of God. That's how you believe. You have to hear something or have information at your disposal before you can determine what you believe. Before you will have a foundation for believing anything. Amen. So beliefs are just an accumulation of a whole lot of knowledge. And when you know the facts about what Jesus has done, the price he's paid, the life he gave, the battle he fought, and the victory he won, when you know the story, oh, it's in the story. It's in the story. Amen. Sister Dorothy, amen. Just write this down. I love to tell the story of his, I forgot that. How many have heard this story? I love to tell the story. The story of Jesus is a beautiful what story? How he came from glory. Amen. To save a wretch like me. So when you confess that, when you believe it, you have to hear it and hear it and hear it and hear it and hear it. And after a while, you say, I do believe that Jesus fought the battle and won the victory. I do believe he defeated Satan. I do believe that I'm delivered from the power of darkness because Jesus has already what? Took my place, became sin for me. When you hear it enough, if you're around Northside, you're going to hear it a whole lot of times, right? You're going to hear it in prayer. Amen. Pray. You're going to hear it in what? Confession, testimony. Amen. So that's the way you overcome by the blood of the Lamb. Everybody said the blood of the Lamb. Amen. The work that Jesus has done for you. How many know we've been bought with a price? Amen. A great price. That's how we know that we are redeemed. Everything that God says about us is true, and it is what? A fact. Because the work has already been done. Amen. But what happens is this, y'all watch this, many times that will never become real to you. It will never work in your life until you set yourself in agreement with what God has already what said or done. You have to set yourself in agreement. You have to say, yes, I believe that with the heart, man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. You have to say that and what believe it. Amen. That's the reason why I always say, as he is, so am I. Amen. I dare you to say it, as he is. Ooh, my shut up, I'm sure. Ooh, glory, as he is. If he's strong, that means what? I'm strong. So the weak can say what? I'm strong. Amen. Praise God. I don't see like nobody's excited about that. All right, I'll move on. All right. This word is just good. 1 John 2:15, 16. So we have to focus, although meditation is verbalizing, saying things, but also meditation is also what? Visualizing things. Visualizing. When you speak words, you begin to kind of see the promise from afar off. You begin to see things which be not as though they what are. How many can see things coming your way before you actually receive what you can see? How many can see things in the spirit? When words are spoken with your mouth, you can begin to what, see those things materializing for you. My sister, he'll always say, if you can't see it before you see it, you'll never see it. Amen. That's almost saying Christ was when Jesus was not, when Jesus was not, when Christ was not. A lot of times people don't understand things like that. Amen. But I understand that it's verbalizing and what? You got to what? You got to what? Visualize. Amen. How many can say amen? And then also you have to what? Internalize or actualize. You got to have, amen, enjoy the blessing, the thing. How many believe you can enjoy something before you actually receive it? Enjoy it in the spirit. Amen. Y'all don't have my enjoy it in the spirit. Everybody say enjoy it in the spirit. That's the part of your walk with the Lord is meditation. Everybody says meditation too. Rejoicing for something before you get it. Remember, how many of y'all love that? Rejoicing for something before you get it. That's the rejoicing. That's the thing that makes the thing you see what? Reality. Oh, man. Poor boy. Pray that your eyes that you understand me. Amen. That's the reason why the Bible says, fear not all your lands. Rejoice, all my people. Rejoice, for the Lord will do what? Great things. The Lord will do great things when you begin to what? Praise Him for things before you receive them. How many can say amen?
Amen.
All right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay. So those are the three aspects of meditation. You say it, then you what? See it. Because words are going to form images of whatever you are saying. You're going to see things in the spirit. You're going to see the blessing before the blessing comes. Amen. Sometimes it can get so finger-licking good before you get it. Just from what? Sight. How many thank you? Thank God for spiritual eyes. Amen. God can reveal things when you begin to what? Say, amen, what the word says. And then the internalizing, internalization. All right, amen. That's the rejoicing part. Turn somebody and say, the rejoicing part is very important. The rejoicing part, amen. Look at somebody and say, why aren't you glad? Why aren't you glad? Amen. All right. Some say, well, when I get the money, I'll be glad. No, it doesn't work that way. You gotta what? You gotta get glad to get the money. Because that's the thing that overcomes all of the obstacles that keep you from receiving. The rejoicing part. It removes a whole lot of obstacles when you begin to rejoice. Well, if I don't preach any further, Sister Irene, I think I've deposited, if you would just apply the little bit I've already said, you would be in pretty good shape. Okay, but that's the part that builds you up because, see, loving not the world and living a holy life is twofold. In other words, you have to separate yourself from evil people, evil influences, evil systems, evil institutions, evil whatever. You have to separate yourself from things that's going to contaminate your heart, your mind. You have to, as much as you can, everybody can't get completely out of harm's way or out of the devil's way or the world's way. But the scripture says that Jesus prayed that not that God takes us out of the world, but He would what, keep us from the things of the world. How many believe that God is a keeper? But you have to what? Do exactly what He says to do in terms of what? Separate yourself from all evil influences. You don't go looking for evil because evil is going to come looking for you. You don't go looking for evil. You don't hang around stuff that's going to what? Mess you up. I don't care how, you might be a Holy Joe or a Super Sally. Amen. But the Bible does not teach that we should what? Choose evil. Bible says abhor it. Run away from it. Have nothing to do with it. Come out from among it. Separate ourselves from it. Love not the world. It says love righteousness and what? Hate evil. Love righteousness and you gotta what? You gotta love righteousness as much as you would hate evil. All right, so there's two sides to the coin. You gotta what? Come out from the world. Amen. You can't be entangled with the what? Yoke of bondage. The Bible says he that that is called for warfare has to what? Amen. This is 2 Timothy 2:4. I want you to turn there. That's the one that I haven't mentioned. And that's one of my key scriptures that I wanted to say. It says, no man that warreth, this is 2 Timothy 2:4. No man that warreth entangled. This is speaking about a soldier. It's speaking about enduring hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life. So that's the scripture. That's saying the same thing. Be not conformed to the world, but be ye what? Transformed by the renewal of your mind. It's saying basically the same thing, but it says a different way. I like this because a man that's a good soldier, he is not, he can't entangle himself with the affairs of this life. In other words, he doesn't have the privilege of what? Getting involved in what? The things that surrounds him in affairs that pertain to life, a world. He has a specific what? Mission, and he has to operate in the what? In the framework of what he has been called to do. Amen. He can't go shopping whenever he wants to. He can't, you know, amen, praise God, violate the rules and the standards and the of the institution that he's under. All right. So he can't entangle himself with the affairs of this life that he may please him who had chosen him to be a what? Soldier. So his objective is to what? Please him, amen, who has chosen him to be a soldier. So he can't get involved in things that does not pertain to his what? To his rights and privileges as a soldier. His duties and responsibilities. They have some downtime, I'm sure, but as a rule, that time is what? Very restricted and guarded. Their main objective is to what? Carry out the will of the what? Military. How many can say amen?
Amen.
All right. That scripture is a scripture that says that we cannot be enmeshed with the things of darkness because they will absolutely water whatever you bleed down to the point where you become very ineffective. Amen. You can lose your testimony when you water what you believe down. When you begin to run with the world and have and get too closely ingrained with their way of thinking, you can absolutely lose your testimony. What I mean by that is that you can talk to people about the Lord and they won't pay you a bit of attention because you become one of them. You become what? Enmeshed into their what system. Think like they think and talk like they talk and do what they do. They ain't gonna pay you no attention. Turn around and say, they ain't gonna pay you no attention. If you don't live a nigga with a dog meat, ain't nobody gonna pay you no attention. That's the reason why God said, I put a difference between what? Holiness. Amen. You're gonna be most effective in dealing with the world when you're least like the world. That's the reason why the Bible says what? Don't love it. Amen. So, all right, let me go there. 1 John 2:13. I'm going to tell you the reasons why there are so many admonitions telling us to come out from the world and do not think like the world, act like the world, talk like the world, do like the world. Amen. Someone said anything that have a tendency to cool you off and make what you believe, amen, less effective and potent, that thing to you is a sin. Amen. That thing is a sin. Anything that cools you off spiritually or takes away some of your what? Desire, motivation, your zeal, and your excitement about the Lord, that's a sin. Anything. God. God said, thou shalt have no other what? God before me. Y'all looking at your watch. That's okay. time for me to sit down and ask you that, but I'm going to say what I need to say. All right. Bible says whatsoever is not of faith is what? Sin. That's what the world is trying to squeeze a little bit of faith you have. Amen. Completely out of you. Whatsoever not of faith is what? Sin. And when you blend and think and talk and act and start adopting the same thing, going to all these worldly events. I wouldn't be calling a worldly event downtown paying $100 or $50 or $25. So some of y'all just feel perfectly happy. I was raised up in a sanctified church, and they taught this. They say all that is in the world, the lust of the eyes, the what? Lust of the flesh and the pride of life, is not of God, it's of the world. And the world is going to what? Pass away. And when Sister Dorothy was saying that someday, she said, on Christ, I saw that what? Rock. I said, all other ground. Ooh, Lord. Master Rita, I was just so worked up. I didn't want her to sit down, but she did sit down a second. I was just so worked up. All Christ are what? Solid rock I stand. All of the ground. That's the reason why you don't want to pitch your tent towards Sodom. Sodom is going down. Y'all knew it went down. God rained what? Fire and brimstone. Even Lot that chose the plains of Jordan because he knew that was what pointed towards Sodom. He knew that's where all the pleasure, the excitement, the good timing. Everybody just popping their fingers. Boy, enjoy, but the pleasures of sin is just for what? A season. A few days, God what? Rained. It became so wicked. See, he was attracted towards Sodom, and he wasn't attracted towards the area, you know, out in the mountains and the hills, and even where no bright lights and no nightclubs and drinking and partying. He wasn't attracted to that. He was attracted to that, but he wasn't attracted to what? Just being out where you didn't have to connect with all of these what? These vices and these people that were doing everything. But he knew, Lot knew that the fun, everybody said the fun. The fun was in Sodom. Everybody said the fun in Sodom. That's where he pitched his tent. He pitched his tent toward what? Sodom. I want fun. I want pleasure. I want what? How many know Lot was a wealthy man? Boy, he had so much stuff that he didn't even have room. Oh, amen. The land was too small to hold his and Abraham. He had multitudes of what? Cattle and who else? Servants and who else? Maids. He had everything. I mean, probably he had hundreds of them by then because they had to separate. And Lot was intent because he wanted what? Position, more wealth. He wanted what? He didn't take in consideration the impact that this might have on his what? Family. He just what? Grabbed at the what? The thing that looked the best. How many, sometimes you always gravitate to the thing that seemed more exciting? Things that seemed dull, boring. So I don't want that. I want where things are what happening. I want to have a good time. All right. Amen. But what happened was that Lot perhaps thought that he was strong enough to go into that city and make an impact because he did become a city official. He said at the gate, that's the place where all the politicians and people that made plans for the city and all that, they congregated there. That's where they transacted and carried out their business operations at the gate. And he was the what? He was at the gate. So he was an official, probably the charge of the gate. Everybody said he was the charge of the gate. So he knew that was a good position, very lucrative, amen, prestigious. And he would know everybody, and everybody would know him, and the money would be real good. But he didn't take in consideration the sinful influence that what that city
could have on him and his family. The Bible says in 2 Peter 2, read this, Sister Hill, again. He said that the environment in Sodom was so great until his soul was vexed. Y'all find that scripture real quick. Amen. How would somebody want to be in an environment and every time you look around, your soul is going to be vexed with the sinful conditions that prevail in that city? But he was very comfortable. He became a what? A part of the what? Part of the what? Part of the program. Anybody find that? 2 Timothy 1, 2 Peter 2, 7. Okay, read it out, Sister Hill. 2 Peter.
And deliberate, just not vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. For that righteous man dwelleth among them, and seeing and hearing, vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds.
Okay, y'all see that he was in a what? Terrible environment. His soul was vexed with their righteous deeds every day, but yet he what? He stayed right there. I missed it. Amen. Because he what? He loved that position. So that is the reason. Now, how many remember when the angels came to Sodom to warn them that the city was going to be destroyed? Abraham. Was the one that he told that he was going to what? Burn it down. He was going to burn it down. And as a result of that, the two strangers, the two angels that came in to warn the city that the city is going to be what? Completely what? Completely destroyed. Fire and brimstone. It was a very wicked city. And here Lot, with all of his family, sitting up in there, part of them, and at the last, you know, when the angels came and went into his house, all of those people gathered at the door, all of these old homosexuals and perverts, they gathered at the door. They say, who are these strangers that you just let in your house? These were the two angels that came down to warn them that the city was going to what? Burn. And so they said, bring them out. We want to know them. We want to have sex with them. So that's the reason why Sodom is considered as a really homosexual city. I mean, that's the word that they got their name from, sodomy, because of their evil deeds and their practice of having men with men, women with women. Incest. See, Lot's daughters eventually end up what? Committing incest with the father. Amen. They learned that in Sodom. They had no idea that it was going to lead to that. All they were thinking about the bright lights and the good times and the pleasures. But the pleasures of sin are just for what? Season. You don't look for the brightest lights. Don't point your tip towards Sodom. Some of y'all's tips point towards Sodom right now. Well, if it's pointing towards Sodom, you better turn it another way. Sodom is going to go down. So the daughter already told you, oh, Christ, on what? Solid rock. Abraham was on the rock, right? Yeah. Amen. And the only reason why Lot wasn't destroyed is God had to what? Come in and take him by the hand and what? Force him out. Yeah. He didn't want to leave. Yeah. Y'all know about his wife. She was going out. He had to force her out. Now she went back. Amen. She was down in Sodom, but Sodom was what? Really in her. Right. She said, I can't leave. I don't want to leave this. Well, it's just too good. Oh, things are just going too good. Just too much fun. All this what? And she looked back.
Amen. Yes.
Brother, when she looked back, what? She turned a pillar of salt.
Amen.
God told her, don't look back. Amen. How many are going to look back to Sodom?
Oh,
no. Don't point towards Sodom and don't look back.
Amen.
Sodom is going down. On Christ, the solid rock I stand, all of the ground is what? Sinking sand. I started to tell Sister Dorothy to sing this, to tack that other song onto it. But I didn't know whether she would flow, I mean, she would want to do it. Maybe, but I didn't call her back. I started to. The other song was that. Oh Christ. Oh, okay, that's the one that she sang, right? Oh Christ, that's the, my hope is real. Only what you do for Christ will last. Only what you do for Christ will what? Will last. Amen. So the daughters, the two daughters that I'm not sure whether they were the daughters, they were the daughter. You know, the sin had prevailed to the extent where Lot was dealing with all of these homosexuals at his door, trying to break in and rape these two angels. How sinful, how more degraded and degenerate can you get? Amen. So Lot offered up his two daughters. He said, well, I can't. It was a custom that they would take care of, you know, strangers when they came into the city. So Lot said, I can't bring these men out and let you have them, have sex with them. I got two daughters on the inside. I'll bring them out and let you have sex with them. I mean, you can see the impact Solomon had on him. He was willing to take his two daughters that had never knew men, never been married, and just what, give them out to that big gang of raven beast, bunch of dogs, and let them just ravish her. He was willing to do that. Amen. So you can see what Sodom, the work that Sodom had on what? Amen. It had done a job on him. But it had been so much better if he had said, well, no, I'm not going to what? Pitch my tent. How many would have said that? I'm not going to pitch my tent towards Sodom. How many going to say, I'm not going to pitch my tent towards Sodom? Now, I'm going to tell you how you can pitch your tent. Amen. You don't have to be dealing with a city like Sodom. The Bible says all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, how many of us do we admit the lust of the flesh, what, the lust of the eyes, and the what, the pride of life, all that is out of God is what is of the world. It's going to what, pass away. How many of you say amen?
Amen.
So we can see, hallelujah, that the thing that's going to, for instance, like, we can see the results. See, God told Israel the reason why he didn't want them to get what enmeshed with the world. Don't love the world. Don't get involved with the practices and the values and all the customs and things that the world do. Because the world is, I mean, that is designed to what? Squeeze you into their mold. That's the reason the scripture says in Romans 12:2, be not conformed to this world. Everybody just repeat that with me. Be not conformed to this world. Say that again. Be not conformed. Say it again. Be not what? Say it again. Say it again. Yeah. Amen. But be ye what? That means don't do what the world does. Don't follow the world, the trend, the tendency, the pattern, the desires, the standards of the world. Do not let the world squeeze you. Everybody said, don't let the world squeeze you. In its mold. You are to be what? The influence to what? Change. Bible says ye are the what? Light of the world. You are what? A city that sits on a hill that what? Can't be hid. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt, oh glory, have lost its savior, if salt has lost its what? Salt ability, amen, the ability what? To make salty. Amen. It's good for nothing but to be what? Cast out and to be trodden under the foot of men. Amen. How many can say amen? So that's the reason why if you let the world squeeze you in your mind, you cease to be that what? That influence, that powerful example, that ability to, amen, to cause them to what? To fear the Lord and to really respect the word of God that's coming from your heart. That's the reason why, how many remember, it was David when he had sinned against the Lord. This was the lust of the flesh. And he sinned by doing what? Committing adultery with who? Bathsheba. And as a result of that, Nathan was that prophet that what? God revealed it to him. And he approached him and told him that you are the man. And he gave him a little story, and the story, amen, convicted him and convinced him that he needed to what? Repent. Amen. Psalms 51 is the story of his repentance. But it didn't hold off the consequences of his what? His misdeed. Amen. See, that's the problem, is that you can get forgiven, you can get what? The sin taken care of, but the consequences, you still have to what? In many cases, you have to what? You have to pay. God told David that what? The sword shall not depart from your house. Daughter got raped by the brother. Is that right? The brother that raped her got killed by what? The other brother, Absalom. Absalom that killed the brother. Amen. He tried to what? Dethrone his dad. I mean, just made an open spectacle before all Israel by committing adultery with all of his brother's concubines and wives up on the top of the top of the palace. He showed up his daddy big time. But the same son, amen, he got hung as he was what? Trying to flee from those that were pursuing him. And his hair got caught up in a what? A branch of a tree. And he was left suspended between heaven and earth in that branch. And somebody came in and stuck the dagger right through his heart. See, God knows that the consequences of violating his laws and becoming a part of the world and doing with the world and following that example is going to be what? Very detrimental to you, and also it's going to be very detrimental to your family. That's the reason why God told Israel to what? Separate themselves, and he gave them all of those laws and all of those ceremonies and all of those what? Rules and status, because he wanted them to be a what? Separate nation. He didn't want them to be like the other nations of the earth, because if they became like the other nations and really began to what? Follow the patterns and the idolatry and all of the detestable things that the other nations did, then God said what? They would have to be what? Destroyed. His blessings would be able to be upon them. Amen. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Oh, glory. Hallelujah. All right. Hallelujah. All right. Let's turn the corner. Time is about up. I want you to turn to Deuteronomy 17, and I want you to see that Solomon was one of the greatest kings, perhaps the greatest king Israel ever had outside of David. But David was the one that obeyed, and Solomon was the one that got off after 20 years. He was a perfect king for about 20 years. He was a perfect king. Now turn over to Deuteronomy. I want you to turn to Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 17. Numbers, Deuteronomy. Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Okay, Deuteronomy 17. Now here are the things that, I hope I have the right scripture here. All right. Okay, the 14th verse. Everybody said the 14th verse. When thou art come, Deuteronomy 17, 14. When thou art come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, and shall possess it, and shall dwell therein, and shall say, I will set a king over me, like as all the nations that are about me. This is concerning kings. Thou shalt in any wise set him king over thee, whom the Lord thy God shall choose. One from among thy brethren shalt thou set king over thee. Thou mayest not set a stranger over thee, which is not thy brother. Okay, that means that when they get ready to install a king, they would have to get a what? A person that is a what? Of their nation. They have the same values, the same what? Standards, the same word, the same covenant, the same amen, ordinances that Moses would have established. Everybody say that. See, God was very particular about, but he shall not multiply horses to himself. This was one of the rules. He can't multiply, he can't go down in Egypt and buy what? Horses. They were never to return back to Egypt for nothing. Nor cause the people to return to Egypt, to the end that he should multiply horses. For as much as the Lord has said unto you, ye shall henceforth return no more that way. See, God don't want you to go back down in Egypt for what? For him. He don't want you to turn to the devil, what? For directions, for guidance, for wisdom. Amen. For a way, for, amen, praise God. He doesn't want you to get involved with what? The devil's way. Neither shall he multiply wives to himself, that his heart turn not away. Neither shall he greatly multiply to himself silver and gold. And it shall be when he sitteth upon the throne of his kingdom, that he shall write him a copy of this law in a book out of that which is before the priests, the Levites. And it shall be with him, and he shall read therein all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God, to keep all the words of this law and these statutes, to do them, that his heart be not lifted up above his brethren, and that he turn not aside from the commandment to the right hand or to the left, to the end that he may prolong his days and his kingdom, he and his children, in the midst of Israel. Okay, turn over to 1 Kings 11, and you can see that Solomon's downfall was directly related to doing exactly the opposite of what God had what told him to do. But for 20 years, he was a perfect king, and Israel rose to the height, to the pinnacle of his history. That's the time that Israel became the most prominent nation, the most wealthiest, most, amen, Solomon was the wisest man. People came from all over the world to hear the wisdom of Solomon. Okay, but look here, chapter 11, verse 2. Of the nations concerning which the Lord said unto the children of Israel, ye shall not go into them, neither shall they come in unto you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. Solomon played unto these and what? And he had 700 what? Wives, princes, and 300 what? Concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. See, that's what the world will do when you get what? Mixed up. Bible says keep yourself unspotted from the world. Alright. For it came to pass when Solomon was old that his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God as was the heart of David. Verse 9. And the Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart was turned from the Lord God of Israel, which had appeared unto him what? Twice. So that's the motivation behind all of these scriptures in the New Testament about coming out from among them. Don't be entangled. He that war, do not get himself what entangled with the affairs of this life. Keep yourself unspotted from the world. Love! Ooh, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. Have nothing to do with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind. That's the motivation, because it has a tendency what? To turn your heart the other way. How many can say amen?
Amen.
And also it causes you to what? Lose your influence over people that you need to reach. Nobody will what? Listen to you, believe in you, or want to follow your example. That's the way it happened to David. When he had sinned and done that abominable thing, God said, you have just made the occasion for people that don't believe, all these heathens around me that need to be saved. Now, amen, you won't be able to what? To influence them. Amen. You've set the occasion for them what? To trespass. In other words, they can just look at your example and say, there's nothing to it. there is nothing to it. Amen. How many want to pitch your tent? Amen. Towards heaven. You don't want to pitch it toward what? Sodom. Sodom is what? Going down. It's going to be what? Burnt to ashes. Every single person in Sodom, except for those that the Lord was snatched out, took them outside of the city. Amen. Everything went down. All of that wealth, you know, listen to me. All of the wealth, what about all of those servants cattle and all of that great wealth the man had? What happened to that? What happened? Got buried. Buried. Amen. So I'm going to agree with Sister Dorothy. My hope is filled on what? Nothing else but Jesus Christ and his what? Righteousness. Hey, hallelujah. Praise God. Only what you do for Christ will what? Will last. Amen. Only what you do for him will be counted in the end. Amen. That's the reason why I think that holiness and sanctification and keeping yourself straight. Bible says that. Stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has set you free, and be not in what? Entangled again with the what? Yoke of bondage. Amen. If it's not built on Christ, it's going to what? Go down. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Yes. All right. Everybody stand wherever you are. Praise God. I hope. Amen. I covered one side of the sanctification issue, but I want to get into the part that you got to what? Put something in you.